Hello, everyone. Welcome to another exciting episode of the Podcast Boys. This is the podcast where me and my co-host talk about Twin Peaks episode by episode. I am joined by my co-host, Connor Nielsen. Connor, how are you doing today?
I'm doing A-OK. How are you doing, Comic Skip?
I'm doing very well. And today we are going to be talking about Twin Peaks The Return, also known as Twin Peaks Season 3, Episode 9. And Connor, why don't you tell us a little bit about the plot of this episode?
Well, this episode could be called Part 9, The Plot Thickens, because it opens with Doppel Cooper walking down a road. He's covered in blood and he finds a red bandana. The next scene, we have Gordon Cole, Agent Tammy Preston, Agent Albert Rosenfield, and then Diana's with them. They are in their plane leaving South Dakota when they get the word that, remember how the people from the Pentagon, where Ernie Hudson sent that one girl to Buckhorn, South Dakota, to investigate the body that turned out to be Garland Briggs? Well, remember when they said that if it is more than just fingerprints, they'll need to get the FBI involved? Well, now Gordon Cole is getting involved because this is a Blue Rose case. So they also get word from the warden of the prison that Coop flew the coop, which is one of my favorite callback lines. And that was so they're like, well, we got to stick around in Buckhorn a little bit longer. Sorry, we need to stick in South Dakota a little bit longer. So they turn the plane around. Then Cooper finishes walking back to what I assume is the farm from last episode. Ray said he was going to a place called the farm. I don't know if he's here or not, but he meets up with Tim Roth, who just so happens to be related to Jennifer Jason Leigh from the first episode, who makes a return here. And they seem to be in it together. And this is just kind of a way to establish that Cooper has a bit of a contingency plan for whatever is happening. He texts somebody on the phone with like a really old phone, and he sends it. He says hi to what's her face, and he says, Tim Roth and Jennifer Jason Leigh, you guys got to go and kill the warden and who else was he say? Abigail, you have to kill the warden first, though, and then you need to go kill somebody else. And then so they leave, and he says, kill this phone to Tim Roth. And I was thinking, please shoot it with your shotgun, Tim Roth. And then he actually shot it with the shotgun, which was awesome. So then we get an amusing scene with – not amusing. So then what's-his-face? Cooper calls the guy from Nevada from like who's been – who has Danny Randis as like a business associate. So I was right. He is related to Doppelcoop. I think this is the guy who he said in the first episode to Danny Rand, don't let this guy – don't let a guy like him into your life. I'm assuming that Tim Roth is Jennifer Jason Leigh's husband, and I guess he might be something that I don't want to say on the air because he's like, hey, honey, why don't you give Cooper a kiss over here? So then he does, and he seems to really enjoy that, which is weird. So then we get an amusing scene at the police department in Nevada where Cooper's boss is talking to the people, to the detectives led by Todd Packard. And we have an amusing scene where he's drinking coffee, and then David Koechner, a.k.a. Todd Packard from The Office, switches out a cup with the cup that Dougie has, and then he's going to like get print and DNA from Dougie, and he gives it to somebody who says that they have Ike Spike, who is the little assassin guy. They have word on him. They say, sweet, we have Ike Spike. Cooper notices the American flag. He notices red shoes that look like the red shoes that Audrey wore in the early episodes of the original Twin Peaks, and then he notices an electric socket. And then after this, they go to the motel and they subdue Ike the Spike, who has a big cast on his arm. They also joke about a taillight, and there's a funny little amusing goofy stuff about that. After this, we get a little shenanigans with Andy and Lucy. Then we get a weird scene with a kid named Johnny running around, and the credits do confirm this is Johnny Porn, who was Audrey's special needs brother, older brother, I think. After this, we have Bobby, Hawk, and the Sheriff Frank Truman go to visit Bobby's mom, and she says that she knew this day would come because before Garland left for work and died, he said this would happen and to give them a thing. She goes to the chair and pulls out a little metal something, and then they all go away. Then Albert, Tammy Preston, Gordon Cole, and Albert Rosenfield get to Buckhorn, South Dakota, and meet up with our favorite people at the police department. Diane sits in the waiting room and smokes a cigarette, and then she looks down at her phone and gets the text message that Doppelcoop sent earlier. So are they related? Does she not? What's going on here? We might discuss this later. So they find the body of Major Briggs, and we kind of figure out more or less what we've already known. The ring comes back into play that says to Dougie from Janie E. And it looks like sparks might be flying between Constance and Albert. They seem to be making snarky comments together and enjoying each other's company. What happens is Gordon pulls what's-his-face, Albert, to the side and is saying, hey, this is really, really strange. This all seems to be related to Cooper. Maybe we need to go to Twin Peaks, maybe not. I don't know if they say that, but I think they're going to be going to Twin Peaks pretty soon. Then we get a weird, some more wacky hijinks with Mega High Jerry Horn in the woods. He is really scared of his foot right now. Then, so Bobby, Hawk, and Sheriff Frank Truman get back to the police station. Chad is eating lunch in the break room, and sorry, in the conference room, I think, and they say, get out of here. So then he slowly gets out of there, and Hawk only helps him when asked. So after it takes him forever to get into it, Bobby says, oh, I know how to open it. We got to go back outside. And he's kind of laughing at him because he's just playing with him. So they go back outside, and then he finds a way to open up this little metal container, and it contains a weird little clue to a place that Bobby and his dad made up in make-believe land, and then also is a little bit of the owls are not what they seem messages, but it's the Cooper. And they say, wow, there's two Coopers. And these little transmissions are from the early days of season two, where Garland Briggs, I think, first talked to Dale for the first time. After this, we get a scene back at the police department in Buckhorn, South Dakota, where Principal Shaggy comes back. But you didn't expect that to happen. Harry Preston interrogates him. He explains a story about he and Ruth Davenport were really kind of getting interested in the occult and like other dimensions, and they ran a little blog called The Zone, and he describes how they met a Major Briggs, and he confirms that it was him, and that he said Cooper, again, two Coopers, and then floated away, and then the next thing he knew, Ruth was dead, he was in his home. And then he talks about how he loved her, wanted to go to the Bahamas, and then Albert ends with calling him a fruitcake. Classic Albert. Then we get a scene with that dog Ben Horn and Ashley Judd. She seems to trying to seduce him, and he's like, look at you're like super attractive and I would, but I don't want to do that. And she's like, hey, you're a good man. So then we get a scene at the what's it called, the Bang Bang Bar, between two new characters, one who looks a lot like the 119 mom, but I don't think it is that same person, and then another girl who has gotten a new job after getting fired from another job for showing up to work high, but she has this weird strange rash. Then the band from the ending of episode four, the band of three that's led by Dakota Johnson, yeah, they sing a song and then the episode's over. I think I might have missed one or two scenes, but I think I was pretty thorough. Okay, Comics Kid, what did you think of this episode of Twin Peaks?
So I wouldn't go so far as to say that I liked this episode, but there were a lot of things about it I liked. There were several lines of dialogue that made me laugh out loud. Whenever Diane is smoking and the cop from The Dark Knight Rises says, ma'am, you can't smoke in here. And she says, it's a blank morgue. I thought that was really funny. And she screams it out loud. I liked when Albert said, what happens in season two? I thought that was really funny. There was one you just mentioned earlier that was really funny. When Jerry is looking at his shoe, that whole scene is completely pointless, but I was grinning from ear to ear that whole time. So we cut down to Jerry's shoe, and we hear this tiny squeaky voice say, I am not your shoe. And I was just like, what? Like, and like, he's got this terrified look on his face. It doesn't make any sense at all, but it's hilarious. I enjoyed that quite a bit. I like the twist. I'm assuming that Diane is playing Gordon and Al like a fiddle, and that she's actually working with Evil Cooper. I'm assuming that based on her getting text messages from him and not telling anyone that she's getting these messages. So that's interesting. That's a neat twist. I was not expecting that. It certainly turns the Diane Cooper dynamic on its head, because she was always seen as like Cooper's, I guess you could say, Cooper's consciousness from the old show. So it's weird now that she's seemingly working with Evil Cooper. I'm trying to think if there's anything else. The cops, they got on my nerves. Todd Packer and his friends, every time they were laughing about something, I was just like wanting to fast forward. It's like, shut up, just get back to doing police work. Like, and like some of their jokes were kind of funny. Like when they said, we got your palm print. In fact, we got your whole palm. That was funny because, his hand melted off. But that just the annoying laugh was just kind of like, okay, you're annoying. Stop laughing right now. I'm trying to think if there's anything else that's like worth mentioning. I don't really need new characters being introduced this late in the game. I feel like we've already got so many balls up in the air right now. We don't need to be introducing new characters with a new subplot.
I hear you. Also in this episode, we got Gordon smoking with Diane, where he takes his first puff of a cigarette, because he said in a few episodes ago that he quit.
And I like that. What's that younger agent's name? You just said it a few minutes ago. What's her name?
I think it's Tammy Preston. I know her last name is Preston.
I liked her awkwardness whenever Gordon and her went outside to join Diane. Clearly, Agent Preston does not like Diane, and Diane does not like anybody. And whenever Gordon reached for the cigarette, Preston was like, no, don't do it. And then he smokes, and she's just kind of like, ugh. And I like that. I really like this almost like queen bee competitiveness between these two women. I mean, like, Agent Preston is probably like 20 years younger than Diane, but I kind of like the discomfort between them. I like the scene between Andy and Lucy. In fact, this episode, Lucy did not get on my nerves once. I was really surprised because at first when Lucy like got up and said, I really like the beige chair, I was thinking, oh no, this is going to be like 5 minutes long of them arguing about a chair. And then like when Andy finally says, I'm sorry, we can get the beige chair. And then she gets the red chair anyway. And I was thinking, okay, I guess she preferred the red chair, but she was doing like a reverse psychology thing on him. So I thought that was kind of funny, a cute little thing for them. And then when they came into the police station and they said, hey, Lucy, and she said, I'm not here. I'm on my lunch break. I thought that was really funny. That sounds exactly like something I would say if a coworker tried to talk to me while I was on lunch. And then when they were leaving the police station, she's like holding up her hand, and it's halfway like waving and halfway like, don't talk to me. I'm still on my lunch break.
Yeah.
I like that. I thought that was funny. I simultaneously got a huge cathartic kick out of everyone being a jerk to Chad while simultaneously feeling a little bit sorry for him, even though he is like, one of the most morally reprehensible characters in the series. Like, I still felt a little bit sorry for him when they were kicking him out of the break room or the conference room. But anyway, that may be all I have to say. I know there's more to talk about here, but that was my initial thoughts. What do you think?
I thought this episode was awesome. It was great. I loved it. This is so strange. This is a much faster paced episode than anything else in the show, or at least this season. Where I was not expecting in this episode, where we have the cops in Buckhorn, not sorry, in Nevada. They say something along the lines of, okay, we got his DNA, but we also got a word on Ike the Spike. And they're like, all right, let's go find Ike. I'm like, okay, we're not going to see that until next episode. And then we get it in the next scene. Like, oh, wow, this is awesome. Sweet. Then we have the stuff where Bobby, Hawk, and Truman. They come to visit Bobby's mom, and she says, my husband said, give them this. Follow me. I'm like, okay, they're going to leave the house and go somewhere, and we're going to figure out what this is next episode. And then she walks over to the chair, and she says, this is the chair. Look at this. And so she pulls it out. And, oh, okay, so we're going to figure out what this is, and then in the next episode, we're going to figure out what's in it. No, no, no. Because then, like, a few scenes later, they actually go back to the police department and then open it up. I'm like, okay, we're going to find out what's in it, like, next episode. No, no, no. We find out in this episode what's in it, and then we find out about a little story about Bobby and his dad and stuff. And this was a really nice, like, Bobby character building stuff, because we got, like, the image of him in his uniform in episode 5 or 4 or somewhere in there. And that was, like, yeah, that hit me like a ton of bricks. I'm like, oh my gosh, you can just look at him and see all the history that's kind of transpired in 25 years. But this time we got a little bit more nuance about the relationship between him and his dad, and what his dad wanted for him, and his dad's faith in him. And that was just really heartwarming, and I really liked it. And I really want to talk about the stuff with Bobby's dad and like this what's it called, Jack Rabbit's Palace. But then we also get the stuff with like the two Coopers, and like that is. Like, they obviously didn't set that up when they were making the first couple seasons, but it is such a natural, like, integration of classic Twin Peaks, and it's a clever use of taking stuff that you had, and somebody, like, oh my gosh, there's going to be two Coopers, and it just so happened to have this, like, piece of space garbage that aligned in early season 2, and I cut out where it said, Coop, like, the two Coopers, so you know there's just two Coopers. And then later... Gordon Cole, Albert Rosenfield, and Tammy Preston are interviewing Principal Shaggy, and he says, and then the major said, Cooper, Cooper, then disappeared. And then I'm thinking, two Coopers! Like, that's two things that directly relate to one another. Mm-hmm. Like, this was like, it was like, almost like, whoa, show, slow down. You might be taking too much, more than, this might be too fast for you. Because last episode, we got a lot of backstory and things that I think are going to come back up periodically throughout the season, but it was mostly a standalone episode. But this episode, it almost seems like it was making up plot progression for two episodes as opposed to just the one. So I found this extremely satisfying. I thought all the integration of classic Twin Peaks was wonderful. I think that we get a lot of progression on this particular story, and it was really nice to see Jennifer Jason Leigh again. It was so good to see Principal Shaggy again. We didn't even think he was going to be coming back. And then Tim Roth showed up, and I love Tim Roth. He is one of my favorite actors, and he has this ridiculous Southern accent, and he's this complete schmuck, and something that rhymes with schmuck. And he shoots a phone. Like, I remember me and Spencer were watching this last night, and I said, Spencer, sorry, I didn't say anything while we were watching this, but when Cooper says shoot this phone, and he throws it on the ground. I'm thinking, please shoot that phone. Just shoot it. He said, kill the phone. Just shoot it to death. And then he turns over and he shoots it. Both me and Spencer went, yeah, and he did it. So I love this episode. I thought it was great. I can't believe I have to wait six more days until the next one.
I also got a big kick out of Tim Roth with a Southern accent. I've never seen him in anything where he has a Southern accent before. I don't keep up with his career very much. I've seen him just scattered throughout things.
He's not in a lot.
I saw him in Reservoir Dogs. I really liked him in that. He was in The Incredible Hulk. And then I didn't watch it, but there was this TV show about 10 years ago called Lie to Me. And he was like somehow worked with the police or the government or something. And it was like a serial killer show maybe. I don't know anything about it, but he was in that. But he's a good actor, and I was really entertained by him playing a hillbilly. I keep expecting all of Evil Cooper's minions to get killed, because so far, like, most of them he's betrayed. So I keep expecting him to betray Jennifer Jason Leigh and Tim Roth, and so far it hasn't happened. But I like that. I liked getting to see Matthew Willard again. Like you said, I didn't think we were ever going to see him again. I was entertained by him just crying like a baby in that cell. And then Agent Preston being the one interviewing him. Like, I was really expecting it to be Al or Gordon Cole interviewing him. I would have enjoyed that a lot more, I think, because if it was Al, you know he wouldn't have put up with that. He would have just, like, said, shut up, stop crying. But I really liked that scene. The coop flew the coop. While I liked that line, I was really disappointed that we didn't follow up more on that. But now that you've mentioned that there was so many things in this episode that were introduced here and then followed up on here, I'm willing to forgive them not following up on Evil Cooper escaping, because now the FBI knows that Evil Cooper has escaped, but they haven't done anything to, like, investigate that. But that's really the only thing that was introduced here that they didn't follow up on. Like you said, there was a whole bunch of other stuff that they started and then followed up on in this episode. So it is moving a lot faster than some of the other episodes have.
Yeah, I was thinking something was going to happen where they were going to say, like, oh, we gotta talk to Will Hastings. Okay, that'll happen next episode. Mm-hmm. And then, like, the next scene, they're talking to him. I went, no, what I thought was going to happen was they were going to talk to him the next episode, and then when they showed up, his head was going to be crushed because the woodsman was in, like, two cells over. So I was like, oh, that really was all we got out of Principal Shaggy. Mm-hmm. But then he showed up, and they were interviewing him. Like, okay, this is great. Okay, awesome. Tim Roth and Jennifer Jason Leigh were in Quentin Tarantino's last film, The Hateful Eight.
Oh, okay.
So it was a bit of a reunion between the two of them, where Jennifer Jason Leigh still has got her Southern accent from that show, from that movie. But the thing is, Tim Roth is playing, like, an English gentleman in the Hateful Eight, where he's all, oh, hello there, my name is Reginald blah blah blah. Like, he talked just like that the whole time. Mm-hmm. And it's ridiculous and it's hilarious. But he showed up and he had a Southern accent, and for a split second I was thinking, did they recast Philip Jeffries as Tim Roth? For a split second, I thought that was what was going down. But then he didn't carry himself like Philip Jeffries did.
No.
Philip Jeffries, like, walked distinctly, and he's tall, and he's Tim Roth is sort of like, hey man, how's it going? I'm like, okay, no, it's Tim Roth. So yeah, I like seeing them. Tammy Preston is here. I think it's fine that interviewing people because Gordon would be hilarious to see interrogate somebody because he would just yell at them. Or mishear what they're saying and like think that they're saying bad words at him, and Albert would love it. So yeah, I would think for a while that I don't get why Tammy Preston is here, but she's justifying her existence, which is fine.
I'm expecting them, in the very first scene of this episode, they're kind of showing the FBI
have their hands tangled up in a lot of stuff that's happening in South Dakota. So to me, it's fine if they're not following up on Cooper leaving just yet. So that's fine for me right now. Coop flew the coop is a direct reference to when Albert is talking to Cooper at the beginning of season two when he says, Wyndham Earl has escaped, and he says, he flew the coop, Coop.
Oh, okay, I didn't remember that.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You were saying that you don't think that they had been planning that far ahead whenever Major Garland Briggs showed the paper to Cooper and it said, Cooper, Cooper. I'm wondering if they were not necessarily. I don't think they were planning the return way back when they were doing season two. But usually, I think, and now I've never been involved with the running of a show, but like I've heard some people who like in commentaries and stuff where they would say that usually, like at the beginning of a season, they already have a really good idea of how that season is going to end. And so I'm thinking when they were doing season two, at the beginning of season two, that they already knew that Cooper was going to be possessed by Bob. Maybe they didn't. That was one of those shows that they seemed like they were just kind of going by the seat of their pants and like, hey, let's go ahead and introduce the Cougar Lady and let's go ahead and have Ben Horn go crazy and think that he's in the Civil War. So maybe they didn't know how the season was going to end, but I'm wondering if whenever they did the paper that said Cooper Cooper on it, I'm wondering if they did already know that, and then they're just using that and capitalizing on it here.
I guess you put that idea in my head, they probably did have an idea that there would be a doppelgänger running around while the real Cooper's still in the lodge.
So maybe,
because the original paper has like five Coopers on it, like Cooper, 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 Cooper. So they just have two of them.
I think what's cool is
it says Cooper, Cooper, and it says slash C O, and then it's cut off. So it's like two and a half Coopers.
So Dougie might qualify as half a Cooper.
We get a little bit of mileage on Dougie this episode.
Find out that he has no record of existing before 1997 or 98 or somewhere in there.
And I thought that was kind of neat. And the cipher might be a person in witness protection, maybe. But that does show that Doppel Cooper manufactured him in the 90s.
I think Doppel Cooper manufactured him to take his place.
Yeah. Which means that he must have had. I'm wondering if before 1997, if he just didn't have any idea that he was going to be that the Red Room was going to try and pull him back in, if he didn't know about that until 1997.
Maybe manufacturing people takes longer than you think.
Yeah, that could be too. When you don't have an atomic bomb and bubbles. I'm trying to think if there was anything else in this episode that I just really liked. Were you as entertained by Jerry and his foot as I was?
I thought it was wild.
I thought that was hilarious. Like, I have no idea what they're going to be doing with Dr. Jacoby and with, like, Nadine and Jerry and, like, you know, these characters who have just briefly shown up. Like, you know, we saw that Nadine and Jerry watched Dr. Jacoby's internet broadcasts. I don't know what they're going to be doing with these characters, but, like, that was the funniest thing this entire series so far, I think.
It ties into a couple episodes ago when Jerry is screaming, I think I'm high! Ben, where's my car? And I saw some people speculating that the car that Matthew McConaughey steals, that he uses to run over the kid.
Maybe he stole that from Jerry
because Jerry's like, "Where's my car? I can't find my car."
That would be interesting.
Which is weird because
Harry goes to visit the owner of the car, and the owner of the car's flipping out, and he's like, I'll meet you in 2 hours at 4:30. Remember, 4:30, Richard didn't lend the two birds with one stone. And so
And then at like 4:30, when Harry's going to meet with him, we cut back to that guy's house, and something has obviously gone down, but we don't actually see anything. But I guess he's the owner of the car, so I don't know if this is in any way related to Jerry freaking out about his car missing. I don't know. It could be, but it could not.
And it might just be two separate incidents that aren't connected, but it'd be very like this series to connect those things too.
The other thing, though, is for the first few episodes, we had just these long sequences of Dr. Jacoby getting shovels and painting shovels and stuff. And the payoff was, he has this internet thing now, where he basically scams people to sell them golden shovels. And then when that was over, we never got any more Dr. Jacoby.
And now we get Jerry rambling in the woods.
So I guess we might just have like these ongoing, to put it in comic book terms, backup stories of people just hanging out in the woods. The first story arc of these backup stories was Dr. Jacoby. And now the backup stories are about Jerry. Maybe Nadine will be next. I don't know. But it is amusing. It is entertaining. I'm interested to see where it goes.
There's a lot of Mark Frost.
Especially when they're talking to Principal Shaggy and he's talking about the zone and alternate dimensions and stuff. That is straight up Mark Frost.
Yeah. That's less Lynch, because you know Lynch is more about emotions and ideas, whereas Mark Frost is more about like. It's hard for me to put this into words because I feel like you're more familiar with what each guy is about, especially Lynch, since you followed more of his career than I have. But I feel like with Frost, he's more about like the weird and the supernatural, like existing in this world, like you know the Red Room and the Black Lodge. That was all Mark Frost, right?
Yeah. The Red Room was created by David Lynch. This was back when they shot the pilot and they were editing it and they were wanting to shop it around. But if it didn't get picked up anywhere, then they were just going to release it as a movie in Europe.
And so the Red Room sequence from the third episode.
That was shot for the unaired pilot.
Okay. So that's all archival footage, and a lot of Cooper's dream is for that alternate ending of the pilot.
Not the entire ending, but some of it was used in the dream. Like it's a 20-minute-long ending sequence apparently, and the whole like dream sequence. David Lynch described that it was like a hot day. They came out of the editing room and he leaned on his cog. He's like, okay, red curtains, zigzag. Floor, dancing midget. I got it. So he just came up with that. But it being the Black Lodge and its mythology surrounding that location is all Mark Frost, because Lynch and Frost, like,
there's more of a blend of it than I think a lot of people give it credit for.
It is clearly the combined vision of two people. And that's a good way of explaining it. Lynch came up with the Red Room and the kind of the way it goes down. But Frost came up with the mythology and the rules surrounding it.
And I think a lot of that mythology stuff, like, you know, I'm a big fan of the mythology stuff, depending on how it's done and, like, in the context of what surrounds it. But I think a lot of that stuff that I like from Season 2 is stuff that Mark Frost brought to the table, if I had to guess.
A lot of the best stuff about season two, the second half of season two, is the ending of the second half of season two, and just like the ending of the series where we go to Owl Cave, we find the symbols, we find out where it's going, and we find out more about the mythology of Twin Peaks and what's going down in the woods and Windham Earl. Like Windham Earl is a like straight up a Mark like it is pure Frost. Windham Earl is a creation of pure Mark Frost, and Frost was a person that's all about like he was probably his vision of Cooper. I think Cooper, the idea for who Cooper was, there was a big disagreement between Lynch and Frost. Lynch was very much Cooper is basically Superman with coffee instead of a cape. He is somebody who is extremely moral. He's basically a Boy Scout. And Frost, I know Cooper has a dark past and he would be corrupted. But he tries to fight it every day. And at the end of the show, We definitely get the Mark Frost interpretation of Cooper,
but we get the David Lynch way of getting to there,
where he does boldly go into the Red Room to save a woman that he loves. Like that's pretty much like the Superman thing, right? He boldly goes in there to save the day, but he comes out corrupted. So it is, once again, a combination of Frost and Lynch, and I think that's why the final episode resonates so well with people, because it once again was those two men coming together in a combined vision.
And we get a little bit of Mark Frost's interpretation of Cooper in his backstory with Wyndham Earl's wife.
That is straight up Frost.
And I like that we get a combination of Lynch's vision and Frost's vision, because I was telling you about this before we recorded. I'm very much a control freak about everything, but if I was working on a story with somebody or a series of stories with somebody, it would be very difficult for me to just let it go and say, okay, I am not the only person working on this. Other people have their own ideas about how this should be handled. It would be very difficult for me to come to that point and just let it go. But when you see that happen, a lot of times it can lead to a better story than what either one person could do alone. I've talked about this before, maybe not on the podcast, boys, but the Dark Phoenix saga in X-Men started off, like, there was different aspects of the story that we got from different people. Like, Chris Claremont wanted to end the story with Jean Grey being cured of the Phoenix Force, and then she and Scott Summers go and have a happy ending, and they basically retire from the X-Men. Because the Dark Phoenix had destroyed a solar system, the editor-in-chief, Jim Shooter, said, and that was happening, she destroyed a solar system, that was because of John Byrne. He added that in there. That wasn't in the script. And then because of that, Jim Shooter, who's the editor-in-chief, said, because she has destroyed a solar system, she can't just get off with a slap on the wrist. We have to kill her, or we have to somehow undo that. And so they said, okay, fine, we'll kill her. And the Dark Phoenix saga would not be the tragic, well-known story that it is today if Scott and Jean got away with a happy ending. So, like, each person involved in that, they had their own contribution to the story, but it was all three of them that brought it together into the story that we know. And I think, you know, if Lynch had gotten away with having Cooper be Superman with coffee instead of a cape, and they did that, or if it was just Mark Frost handling Cooper, we would have had two very different versions of the show that we got.
I completely agree. And
I think both men would probably prefer to have creative control.
But I think the art wouldn't be as good if it wasn't, because they probably realize it. But they work so well together. Like, their combined vision of what Twin Peaks is what makes it so good. And when it is pure Lynch, I don't think it would probably be as good as if it was a combination. And likewise, if it's pure Frost, it is as I don't think it's as emotionally stirring as if it were a combination. Like, I like the stuff with Wyndham Earl coming up towards the end, but it is more of, like, about ideas and kind of like a mythology than an actual story being told. And when Lynch is kind of full-blown going through stuff, it might run the risk of being all emotionally driven and kind of contradict its own rules. So keeping both men in check creates a very great experience, both on an intellectual and emotional level, that I think so anyways. I think if I walk with me, I think you and I would both describe a David Lynch film first more than anything, because I don't think Mark Frost was even involved in that, because the two men had a falling out. But even then, it was incorporating a lot of Frost ideas just because of the world it inhabits. Like, the Owl Cape Ring, I'm sure, is a creation of Mark Frost.
Yeah, definitely.
The owl cape symbol and all this weird mythology is Mark Frost stuff. The owl cape ring was a solution for the film. And Robert Ingalls was co-writer of the film. I guess Robert Ingalls was probably the stand-in for Frost. Because I think, this is all pure speculation. But once Frost and Lynch were kind of out of the picture for season two for a lot of it, because Frost went to go direct a film, and Lynch felt discouraged, so he left. I think Harley Payton and Robert Ingalls kind of took control, and Warren Frost is still there. I think Scott Frost, which is either Warren Frost's brother or son. Scott Frost was involved in the writing of several of those episodes. So I think Robert Ingalls was kind of like the continuity, keeping everything in check. So when they went to go write Firewalk with me, he's sort of the stand-in for Frost. So going into this, I know you hated last episode. I still have mixed feelings on it. I do think I like it. But there's a bit of Frost in there. A lot of Frostian ideas, even though it's the most Lynch presentation imaginable.
You could say it's very Frosty. Sorry. I thought you were going to say that, and I was waiting, and then you didn't. I was like, what? He didn't say that?
It's so frosty that it left you cold. So, boom.
By the way, Scott Frost is the brother of Mark Frost.
Okay.
I think the show, watching this, I realized what the show is. We're now halfway through the show.
Yeah, this show has its identity.
I would argue that it's always had this identity. It just took me a while to catch on to it, to really get what they were even doing. And I rewatched it, rewatched all of these episodes before watching this episode.
And
this show definitely has its own unique identity, its own voice, definitely its own show. I was kind of waiting for it to come into its own without realizing that it kind of was in its own the whole time. It's just a rather impenetrable experience. It's a lot like Blade Runner, right? Where you watch Blade Runner and you're like, that kind of left me cold a little bit. I wasn't really sure about it. Then you kind of research about it. You rewatch it a few times. You watch cuts of it. You get a little bit more information about the world of Blade Runner. And then through that, you can fully get it. Not on an intellectual level, per se, but on like an emotional level. Like, okay, I feel what this movie is now. And then same thing with this, where I finally get this show and the season, and I get what Lynch and Frost are trying to do. And my expectations will probably be subverted, yes, because that's what they like to do. But I get the identity of the show now more than I have, and I was able to probably enjoy this particular episode more than I've enjoyed any other episode, because I feel like I finally got it. And I think a lot of that is because these two men's vision are so well integrated together.
We may have talked about this when we did our like predictions for the season, our hopes and dreams and all that. What was it that caused these two to go their separate ways, and what was it that caused them to go back together for this?
I'm not sure.
I think it was creative differences in season two.
I think we're citing creative differences between us and the studio.
I think a lot of it had to do with season one was their baby. Pretty much, as far as I understand, everyone was on the same page when making season one.
When season two came up, they had to solve the murder mystery. That was something that they were forced to do. And in doing so, I think that's where the splinter started to come.
I think they agreed on who the killer would be, but it was telling how they would get there and what it meant and what they would have to do afterwards.
That's where things started to get a little dicey, and the way character motivations were, the studio was also very much against Cooper and Audrey getting together.
So they're like, okay, what do we do now? And so there was a lot of, oh, you made something people like, you know, ABC was very much like, oh, we don't like this show. You're going to be filling up a time slot that another show got canceled. So now you get the spotlight. After the mid-season break.
So the studios didn't really care about the show. I guess they didn't really like it. They just like, okay, it's a decent pilot.
I'm sure it's got an intriguing mystery. Okay, put it out there. People will watch it. And then it completely took off. And because Hollywood and the entertainment industry is one of the most fickle industries imaginable, now because people care about it, the studio's like, well, hold on. Now this is what we want you to do. Even though they weren't doing that in the first season. So I think the pressure from the studio and it being on network television is sort of what caused the fractured relationship.
Yeah.
And by the end of the second season, from what I understand, they felt there were irreparable differences in their creative vision. So they wouldn't want to work together. And people always say Lynch was less involved in
Twin Peaks season two because he went to go direct Wild at Heart.
No, he shot Wild at Heart after shooting the pilot before beginning production on the proper season one. And I think he was editing Wild at Heart and kind of getting post production done while they were putting season one out. And then once season one was finished, he was doing probably some press for Wild at Heart. But he was mostly doing pre-production and production for season two.
So he was probably just straight up discouraged by the studio.
And he said the biggest problem was we had to tell who the killer was, and that's what killed the show. He felt. So Frost went on to go direct his movie. And so that's kind of like they departed. And I guess somewhere in that time apart, they were able to sort of rekindle their relationship. Because in 2014, I guess they kind of came back together and said, Hey, remember that last episode we did? Laura Palmer says, I'll see you again in 25 years. Kind of coming back around that time again. Maybe want to do something. And I guess they agreed that they both did want to do something. And that's how they came up with this.
And even though I haven't enjoyed a lot of this season, I do like that they were able to come back together. I've said this before, but I always hate it whenever I see people who are friends and then they end up stop being friends, or they go their separate ways, or they have a schism of some kind. So it's cool that they got to repair their friendship, or at least their working relationship. I think it's cool anyway. Did you have anything else to add about this episode? I feel like this is a shorter podcast than normal, but I don't know. I liked a lot of this episode, a lot more than I guess a lot more than I realized, because when I was watching it, I was thinking, well, I like some of it, but I don't know if I like the episode. But talking about it, I really do think I like this episode.
Two things. One, I didn't realize that Dakota Johnson and her band were like really good at harmonizing with one another. Their harmonies were awesome.
This is, I think, the first time that I haven't stopped the episode. Whenever we get to the credits, like in the past, I would just go ahead and turn it off as soon as the credits started rolling. I listened to this one all the way through, and then I went ahead and listened to it again on YouTube.
Oh yeah, it's a good tune.
The other good tune was in an episode where it didn't end, it was when the jazz band was playing, and that's where we met Matthew McConaughey looking guy.
It's like this really cool jazz band.
I think the band is called Trouble, and I think David Lynch's son is the saxophone or guitar player. I can't remember. Is it the same son
who played Mrs. Tremont's nephew?
I don't know, because the people in that band looked rather young.
So I don't know if it was a son he had a little bit later.
But my second point is, what do you think of the whole Ben Horn subplot? He might not be eating carrots anymore, but it seems like he's still a good man.
He's kind of middle of the road. We haven't technically seen him do anything evil this season, but like you said, he's not eating carrots, which was kind of the visual cue for us that he was trying to be a better person. But even Ben Horn, surely back when he was at his most evil, would have drawn the line at having sex with a woman whose husband is crippled. He's crippled, right? Her husband, she's like taking care of him, and there's something that's wrong.
I don't know if he's crippled, but he clearly has medical issues.
Yeah, there's some kind of like he has a nurse, like a live-in nurse, so it's something pretty messed up. And so I feel like even at his worst, Ben Horn would have said, "This is messed up. I shouldn't do this." You know what he looks like to me?
He looks a lot like Adam West and Michael Keaton smashed together.
Ben Horn.
I know Adam West is no longer.
The other guy.
Oh, the Ben Horn.
Old Ben Horn looks like old Adam West and old Michael Keaton smashed together.
Yeah, I can see that. Now that you mention it, I would never have thought that, but once you've mentioned it, it kind of makes sense.
We need to get this guy to be in a Batman movie.
Make it happen, Warner Brothers. Make Richard Beamer in Batman.
He doesn't need to be Alfred.
Maybe you can do a flashback of young Alfred in this, and Ben Horn, Richard Beamer could be Alfred's dad.
That would be great.
You could do the pre-crisis thing where the Pennyworths have always served the Waynes, and when Alfred's dad dies, he's like, "Hey, son, I know you have this promising career in theater, but I want you to go be a butler." And Alfred's like, okay, I guess." And then he does that. That'd be great.
I remember something from this episode, and I forgot it again. I'm just full of forgetfulness today. I think the weird scene, the quick scene with Johnny Horn, is going to be the way Audrey's going to come back into the show.
I'm hoping so, because I know that she was, like, I remember one of the first things I saw about this season was her on Twitter saying, "Look, I'm back. It's Twin Peaks, baby." And she was, like, dressed up as Audrey Horn, and it's been, we're now halfway through this series, and she hasn't shown up yet. So I'm afraid that even when they do bring her in, that it's not going to be a large role, kind of like all of the other veteran Twin Peaks characters who have just had cameos so far. But maybe they'll surprise me.
The thing is, they're clearly telling the story, and we're in the thick of the main story, right? My worry is that they're gonna come to Twin Peaks.
There's not gonna be much story left to tell in Twin Peaks.
Which is weird to me because, like, a lot of the stuff that we've gotten this season is revolving around Evil Cooper and his plans and stuff like that. So, like, you can make that be the main thrust of your 18-episode arc, but not having a story never stopped them from doing stuff in Twin Peaks before. That sounds really mean, but, like, you know, the Cougar Lady and Ben Horn fighting in the Civil War and, like, T.M. Wentz coming to town and all that stuff, like, that was stuff that didn't really need to happen, but it happened anyway. And I think it sounds meaner than what I'm intending it to sound like. I should point that out.
I know what you mean, but the way you said it was funny, and now I'm remembering all of the superfluous subplots. Like, Nadine being a high schooler.
Oh, yeah. Wouldn't it be funny if, like, if they did set this whole season in Twin Peaks, if, like, Nadine, she wasn't actually cured. She was just going back and forth between 18-year-old Nadine and, like, middle-aged Nadine.
Oh my lord.
That'd be like, oh no. But I think that, like, you're right. Like, we don't have a lot of, like, stuff connected to Doppelganger Cooper in Twin Peaks because they had him leave Twin Peaks almost immediately after he possessed Cooper. But I think they could have found ways to do it. Like, you know, the drug stuff going on. Like, is it Norma or Shelley's daughter who's, it's Shelley's daughter.
Shelley's daughter.
You could do stuff with that and have that somehow connect with something else. You know, you could lead into some of this other stuff going on in the town, and it might seem a little superfluous, but it would probably make me happy because it would be in Twin Peaks, and it would be dealing with some of these characters that we've come to love over the past, you know, 30 episodes before this season started.
Yeah, I agree.
What do you think of the whole Ike the Spike thing?
I was like, what happened to his hand?
It's his right hand. And they were purposely keeping it out of focus. I'm like, something's going on with his hand. And then he has a big band.
It seemed like it was shaking or making some kind of noise on its own.
Did you hear that? Did you get that vibe from it at all?
I didn't hear that, but I'm wondering if it's going to be kind of like, you remember near the end of season two, and like you had someone in the in double R, and like they'd be like their hand would start shaking, and like a plate would break or something like that.
Oh yeah.
I wonder if it's gonna be that Ike the Spike, his hand is like shaking. I wonder if that is going to be connected to the noise in the Great Northern that Ben and that one woman are hearing.
Oh yeah.
That'd be interesting if they could somehow connect those two things, and maybe. You know, the laws of nature are saying, like, okay, evil Cooper can escape for a little while, but he has to come back. Like, you know, they were saying at the beginning of the season that he is coming back. And then evil Cooper kind of works a way around it so that he doesn't have to go back. So I'm wondering if, because he has defied the laws of the unnatural, I wonder if this is, like, the world is starting to fall apart because he didn't go back to where he came from.
And what if Ike the Spike's arm falls off
and it turns into an even littler person that dances around?
I am the tiny arm.
I am the tiny arm, and I sound like this. What if that's connected to the foot? What if that connects to Jerry's foot?
I would be very surprised if they brought that into the main plot. I enjoyed the head of that scene, but I don't think that it's actually going to connect. But if it did, I would probably stand up and applaud. Like, alone in the house, I would just start clapping, and I would say, "Bravo, brother! You have similar."
What do you think? So, very quickly, you know, the whole thing, first off, it was so great to see Bobby get more to do here. Dana Ashbrook's awesome, and it's so nice to see Bobby make a life for himself, and seeing him be a police officer, he's just such a nice dude. We still don't know if he's married to Shelley or not, but I don't care because we get a lot of stuff here that is affirms his character.
I like how he plays a joke on Frank and Hawk by making him walk out and back.
And my theory is that, you know, the make-believe place that he and his dad made? I think they're going to go there, and then he's going to knock on the door, and then his dad's going to answer it. It's going to be the Vision from season two.
Oh, okay, huh. And it'll be very interesting to see if they're going to try and work in Major Briggs somehow, because, you know, he died a few years before they started filming the revival. So it'll be interesting because, you know, they've used Frank Silva's face a couple of times here, and he died several years ago, but they were just using archived footage. So I wonder if they're going to try and do something similar to that with Major Briggs.
Maybe we did have archival footage of Major Briggs, Blue Rose. But outside of that, it's mostly just been a body. And references. Maybe he'll knock on the door, the door will open, and he'll walk in, and that'll be that. But that'd be cool to incorporate that vision into the main thrust of this. How do you feel about Bobby's mom saying, "Oh, Darla Briggs told me this would happen"? Because I know this is Twin Peaks, and like people share dreams and all that stuff. But this just seemed a little bit too easy writing for me.
It seemed a little too easy. I don't even know a way to fix it. It was just one of the, I don't know what it was. It just didn't sit right with me.
Okay,
we need to get this over with faster. My husband told me this would happen. Here.
It may be too easy. I'm not going to say that it's not, but I liked it because Bobby's mom never felt like much of a character in the original show, in the same way that we talked about how Sarah Palmer never got to do a whole lot in the series. She was always just there. She was there in the sense that she's Laura's mom and she's Leland's wife, but she's not her own character. And I kind of felt the same way about Bobby's mom. Bobby was very important in the series. Major Briggs was very important in the series. But, like, the Log Lady was more important than Bobby's mom. And so I liked this episode because it makes her a tiny bit more important. Now, it could be that if the actor who played Major Briggs was still alive today, that they wouldn't have even bothered using her, and they would have just had Major Briggs be the character that the police come and talk to, maybe. I don't know, but it kind of reminds me of the Superman movies, how in the first Superman movie by Richard Donner, Jor-El, his hologram was the one that talked to Superman anytime he needed help, but then in the second movie, they couldn't get Marlon Brando to come back, so they used the actress who played Jor-El's wife to talk to Superman. And it, you know, to me, it feels like they are just trying to bring in Garland Briggs, but they can't do it, so they're doing it through his wife. And I like it because it makes her seem a little bit more important. But I agree with you, it probably is too easy, but it didn't bother me.
That's fair. And you know, that actress has been with David Lynch since Eraserhead. She played Mary X from Eraserhead. So, who she somehow gave birth to that weird dinosaur lizard.
Bobby's so, half brother.
I guess. Yeah. That would be amazing. You have a child. I mean, I had it with Pete. This is back in 70s. But the thing is, there's like, I think the part of it that doesn't sit right with me is, oh, your dad knew you'd become a police officer and told me, and I knew it too. He never stopped having faith in me. He was like, the never stop having faith in you part is fine and all that, but it's the part of like, oh, I knew you'd be a police officer and you'd get your life back together. And so, I don't know, it kind of takes away from like, you don't think that his mom would have been like, your dad, you know, thought you were going to be a police officer and you were going to do these great things. And that, then maybe that would have inspired Bobby to become a police officer. It'd been like a weird, like, paradox loop of his dad knew this was going to happen, so he told his wife, and then when he died, his wife told Bobby, and then Bobby fulfilled that kind of prophecy, so to speak. It's just kind of weird that she goes, oh, I knew this would happen. It kind of takes, I don't know what it is, it takes away from the relationship, maybe. I can't even put it into words.
I didn't necessarily read it that she knew that he was going to be a cop. I figured Major Briggs knew, but what he told her was that Hawk, Harry, he said Hawk, Sheriff Truman, and Bobby were going to be asking her questions. And maybe she took that to mean that Harry, Bobby, and Hawk were all going to come together on some mutual mission, and they would be asking her questions. But maybe she didn't realize that he would become a cop, if that makes sense. Now, maybe Major Briggs...
Well, I get that, yeah.
Oh, I get that, yeah.
Because he had the vision, but maybe she didn't know. So it didn't ruin anything for me.
Okay, that's fair.
That's understandable. I can't even really quite explain why something feels slightly off. Anything else you want to talk about in this episode? Because I think I'm good.
I think I am too. I liked it. I wasn't sure how much I liked it whenever we first started talking about it, but I think that it's a very solid episode. This is, in a lot of ways, what I wish this series had been. Like you said, how it'll introduce some kind of subplot, or at least introduce an element in a pre-existing subplot, and then follow up on that subplot in the same episode. I wish that this series had been doing more of that from the beginning, instead of introducing a whole bunch of stuff in an episode, and then following up on some of it in the next episode, and some of it in the next episode after that. I like that this is introducing stuff and following up on it here. Now, in the next episode, we may follow up on some more stuff that we have ignored for a couple of episodes, like that guy running over the kid. We may get back to that. I don't know. But I like that this episode feels like we're moving forward at a good pace.
I agree.
I'm so excited for the next nine episodes. Part of me, I'm kind of falling into that trap, man. The trap that I don't want to fall into of, I still hope this is the ending because I don't want to have awkward. Albert's in South America right now. Pay no attention to that, Albert. I don't want any more of that. I do want this to be over. But I'm also worried that, I mean, we're halfway through. Like, there's still half of the show to get through. But I'm also worried we won't finish it all in time and that we'll need to have another season of this revival to finish it up, a la The X-Files. But,
I knew that would make
me shudder. but at the same time, I don't want it to be over. I only have nine more episodes.
Here's a quick question I'm going to ask you. You know, I agree with you. I want this to be the end of Twin Peaks. But what would you say if they announced today that this is the end of Twin Peaks, but we're going to do a spinoff set in South Dakota involving these cops over here? What would you say to that? Do you think that would work, or do you think that would just be a cash grab?
It would depend who's working on it. That's what it would ultimately come down to. If it's like Mark Frost's Buckhorn, South Dakota, then yes, let's do
and
it.
I would, with
the occasional special guest director by David Lynch, even better.
I would want it to be more comical if they did that. Like, don't have, you know, I don't want to see a murder investigation be the thrust of the series. I would want it to just be like, you know, that's some darn fine coffee, and there was a fish in the percolator. I would want it to be more stuff like that, because the stuff in South Dakota has been some of the best stuff in the series so far. Like, I've been so loving that mortician and the sheriff. I've really been loving that town. So I would love if they could do something like that. I don't know if there's anyone else in Twin Peaks that you could do a spinoff for. Maybe Hawk, but, you know, you'd have to really work to make a series that surrounds him. We would both love that, obviously, but you would have
Obviously, yeah. You just have Hawk move to Buckhorn. Boom, problem solved.
Oh, yeah, that would be great. So I'm assuming your God Bless You Hawk moment of the week is when he refused to open the door for Chad.
Well, I'm glad you brought that up because my God, Bless You Hawk moment of the week is when you refused to open the door for Chad.
That scene was so funny.
That was awesome. It was hilarious.
And like I said, like, we hate this character, okay? We do not like him, but I still felt a little bit sorry for him because they come in and they're like, we don't want you eating in here, Chad. And it's like, wait, you guys, it's like, get out, Chad. And he's like, okay, fine. And he's like, got all this stuff, and I thought he was going to drop his food. And I thought they were all just going to stand there staring at him. And then Hawk is just like staring off, and he's like, aren't you going to get the door? And Hawk is like, fine. And then they don't even use the room. Bobby's like, okay, guys, go ahead and leave.
So
and it's like,
funny.
Oh, poor Chad. And it's like, the next episode, Chad's probably going to be making fun of Harry's kid who killed himself or something like that. But like right now, I just felt so bad for the guy. It's funny.
It's weird because he's weirdly polite for the first time since we've seen him. He's like, oh, I'm sorry, Sheriff Truman, what happened again? And he's like weirdly nice, and he like gets up, and it's like he's walking with all this stuff together, and he almost drops it at one point, and then Hawk is just staring at him, and I thought, oh, Hawk's not going to get the door for him, and then he didn't. And I went, yeah, that's right, Hawk.
It must have been really difficult to almost drop the food but not drop it. Like, that's some really difficult acting right there. But he pulled it off.
Can you imagine shooting that? I think he probably did drop it. Like, there's a reason we don't see the carpet in those shots. I think he might have actually dropped it several times.
Well, that's all we had to say. So we will be back next week to talk about the next episode. In the meantime, I am the Comics Kid 2099.
And I am Connor Nielsen.
And
we will see you guys later. Have a good one.